Psychologist. And special guest, Saul, musician and poet.
Diseases down for some ignorance. Chemicals and feces down for some ignorance. Computers delete us down for some ignorance. Don't care how they treat us down for some ignorance. Fresh on the streets and I'm down for some ignorance. Fear of defeat and I'm down for some ignorance. Stockholders mean and they're down for some ignorance. Fear of the meek and they're down for some ignorance. Down
for that ignorance. Where worlds collide. Hacking the dietary sustenance tradition versus health. Hacking the comfort compliance. Hacking the rebellious gene. Hacking the doctrine, capitalism, and relation of free labor and slavery. All the worlds colliding. An exchange of ideas. But all the things that frighten us, such as AI. Old fears implanted on new fears at the end of the colonial era into the industrial era. When they were building machines, all the machines had masters and slaves. The biggest fear of the slaveholder was that the slaves would learn too much and take over. The biggest fear with AI is that the machines will learn too much and take over. Old fears, new fears. Collision of worlds, collision of meetings, privacy, community, personal data, the ability to clear your history, but can you clear your history? When you open the machines are masters and slaves. We follow, we scurry around, aiming to raise money, to gather attention. A land grab, who will win the land grab? Who won this land grab? Indigenous technology, native technology, the technology of awareness. We can expect more from technology than we expect from ourselves. If we're gonna throw around words like diversity, in order to make them more than mere words, we have to find a way to enact these realities in our lives and not just approach them because we think it's the right thing to do, but because we want to bring out a heightened intelligence, a heightened sense of awareness and the possibility of new forms and paradigm shifts of power. Anyway, I'm here today hanging out with a hacker friend of mine, Ralph and Shimada, and an amazing cyberpsychologist, Mary Aiken. And we're gonna spend some time discussing the role of security, the role of technology, the role of data, the role of humanity, and how these worlds collide. So here we go. Thank you.
Thank you.
Collision. Hello, hello, hello. Hello, hello Collision.
Hey.
Hello, hello.
My name is Ralph Echemendia. I'm the ethical hacker. And right here I've got two very intelligent minds, which you've heard from one already, who's one of my favorite poets of all time. And over here is probably the smartest lady in the entire world, Dr. Mary Aiken.
No pressure then.
In fact, Mary, we actually met because we've done some work in Hollywood, and Mary's actually, there's a series called CSI Cyber that was based on what she does and on her, and initially sort of met because of that, and interestingly enough, we had a lot of similarities where I thought that we wouldn't originally.
Ralph, the feeling was mutual.
So it's been some time now, and bringing this together to be able to kind of talk about the issues, and as we've been talking about how to define really what's going on in this new world, because the truth is that you know, the physical and the virtual have collided into something that is neither physical or virtual. It's both. And we haven't really defined what that means. So what exactly is privacy? What is, you know, when is anonymity something that we should care about and shouldn't care about? So there's just a lot of different things. In fact, to start with Mary, you just came back from D.C. yesterday, where you were, I believe, talking to the U.S. Congress Committee on Intelligence.
Yeah, so the Senate Intelligence Committee, the committee here that are investigating what did or didn't happen in the election here. So basically, you know, they wanted to talk to me as a cyber behavioral scientist and say, well, what does behavioral manipulation online mean? So a couple of things. You know, the first thing that I said to them is that we have to, first of all, have a paradigm shift where we start conceptualizing cyberspace as a place. And once we get to that point, we have to start thinking about environmental psychology and the impact of environment on human behavior. And then we have to segue through to thinking about how human behavior mutates or changes in a cyber context and factor that in. And then you come down to the level of, at one end of the spectrum, you could say that, you know, the use of data, the profiling, the micro-targeting, that that's a form of advertising, that it's a persuasive technology. That's maybe in the best case scenario. But at the other end of the spectrum, you have to think about hacking humans, about cyber behavioral manipulation. And we've been here before. We had the subliminal scare in the 50s. Do you remember that, when they were putting like popcorn and salted products into movies to make you thirsty? Well, this isn't about buying popcorn. This is about changing how you vote. It's a lot more serious.
Yeah. And that's really what we have to be concerned about, because this is really nothing new to me, coming from the hacker background, because it's really, you know, we call it social engineering. Manipulating, it's a type of attack to attack the human factor. You know, it's a lot of psychology involved in doing that, but it's changed now where it's affecting the masses in such a way. You know, back in the day, which isn't that long ago, it would be, you know, the phone was really the trick. If you could pretend to be somebody on the phone and say all the right things, you could get somebody to do something or tell you something that they normally wouldn't. And now we've got the internet, right? So we've got so many different ways, from email to the web itself, meaning browsers and apps and so on and so forth. You know, this recent sort of issue with the elections just goes to show how much you don't know that is actually being done and going on to manipulate your perception. So when you hear terminology like fake news, then the truth is, what is real news today? Because everything is sort of made up, and it's your perception on how you want to sort of digest that. But in my opinion, it is hacking the people, but it's a corporation or the government. So,
yeah, and in that sense, it's not new at all. I mean, you know, like we fought for years to have proper information inside textbooks in a classroom. Mm-hmm. We realized the role of media and entertainment, and how that can, you know, affect what people think about, how they think about things, when they think about things, what have you. Even what I was trying to get to before is this sense of we carry over our issues from this realm into the virtual realm, right? And so hacking into humans, and before we get to computational propaganda, there's propaganda itself. We know the role that propaganda played, during World War II and what have you. And now here we are on the cusp of whatever this reality is now. And of course, technology, media has gone to new forefronts. And with that, the possibilities of distilling greater and greater propaganda has enhanced. And unless we can find a way to fortify ourselves, because we're here what to talk about fortifying our machines.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But we also have to find a way to fortify ourselves against accepting bullshit, i.e. fake news, or propaganda into our minds themselves. And
but so I think that's key to actually start thinking about ourselves as self, not just a data object. We are far more than data objects. And if you talk about behavioral manipulation online, what does that mean? So we know with, Cambridge Analytica and various brokers, everybody thinks it's just Cambridge Analytica. There are up to 4,000 other companies that are operating in a similar way, harvesting data. Everybody thinks that it was as simple as somebody completed a psychometric test, the Big Five, and knew whether you were more agreeable or neurotic. It's not as simple as that. If I got into your network, say you sitting there in the middle, if I got into your network, LinkedIn, Facebook, I could begin to profile you on a score of misogyny, depending on how many females are in your network. I could begin to profile you on a form of, on a score of racism, depending on the ethnic mix in your network. Now, can you imagine if I had all that information in 2014 and 2015? And can you imagine you had a candidate in the real world that was prepared to talk about things that were racist or misogynistic or that were hate speech? Now you can orchestrate cyber and real world together. And that's what it is. This is a gamification of process that happened on an unprecedented scale. This is sedition, an insider threat on a national scale.
I'd say even on a global scale.
Yes, yes. We had Brexit, Germany, France. We've seen similar things. Except in Germany. Do you know why the election wasn't interfered with in Germany? Germans don't like, and apologies, I know we're Facebooking live, we're streaming lies on Facebook, but Germans don't like to take their news from social technology companies. And I think that's why there wasn't the level of interference in their election.
The influence wasn't there.
Now, but that's the crazy thing, is that we all know in history there was a moment where there was a major interference in German elections, right?
Yes. Yep.
And there was a sense of propaganda that spread, and that gullibility of the people, that desire to identify, to belong, to feel empowered and all that. To me, those are the questions I ask when we get here, because I feel like we can keep on putting Band-Aids on this thing, But the fact is that, there is something within our own behavioral science that makes us feel great about identifying with this group beyond what we can protect ourselves against, and that make us ingest this nonsense or look forward to it or say, well, it's easier to think of it that way. I don't really know what.
Okay, so there's a theory behind that. I've written about this, and I call it online syndication. So in the real world, if you're a sex offender in the north of the country and I'm a sex offender in the south of the country, what was the chances of us coming together to normalize and socialize our behavior? It was rare. Mm-hmm. But now, online, under the cover of anonymity, fueled by online disinhibition, within two clicks, we can find like-minded people. And as humans, we're simple creatures, and then if it seems everybody else is doing it and it's okay, then that becomes a new norm. And that's what we've really got to break. And I've just written a paper on mass killings and technology, the hidden links. And if you look at what happened with Elliot Rodgers and that incel rampage in Santa Barbara, and at the time, I asked the question, When he did his manifesto and he spoke into cyberspace, I questioned from a profiling point of view, who is he talking to? Is he talking to the relatives of his victims post-mortem? Or is he talking and trying to inspire like-minded people? And then we had Toronto. So here's the thing. It's one thing to get caught in a filter bubble or echo chamber or feedback loop of working out, like Ralph. Where all they're going to do is push, you know, protein powder and Nike trainers at you. Now think about getting caught in a filter bubble of distorted thinking, of hate speech, of racism. And think about the algorithms actually reinforcing and facilitating and normalizing that. And this is what we're facing into. So people think the internet is just a conduit, like a motorway, you know, an infrastructure. It is something that has the ability to have a powerful and pervasive impact on humans, on the individual and on the group. So in terms of causation correlation, as we say in science, does the internet cause bad behavior? I'm not so sure. I think, and you just touched on it there, Saul, I think what it does is it shines a very bright light into the darkest reaches of the human psyche, what Jung called the 2-million-year-old man. And I'm beginning to wonder, are we all just Game of Thrones underneath it all?
Not all of us.
You see that? He's like, I'm out of here.
Not all of us.
Don't include
me. But it's obvious that there's some powers at work.
Well, I think the thing is that it because of the fact that technology is not necessarily controlled by the powers and the way power was in the past.
It has the capacity, yeah.
You know, like, again, I've been in a, you know, in a situation where I have the power of God at a click. I can take a company down. I can take all your information. I can delete everything on your hard drive. I can
just before you confess, Ralph, you know.
I'm not telling you anything else. But the point is, to have that kind of power, and this goes back to some of the differences between the physical realm and I am not a government. I don't have tanks, and I don't have the kind of power that it took before to have the same level of impact that the internet gives us all, in a way.
Well, that's a really good point, because it costs a lot of money to be a superpower in a real-world context. Armies and navy and airstrike power. To be a superpower in cyberspace, what you need is about a dozen brilliant hackers or scientists or a combination of both and a lot of computing power. So that means, in terms of attribution, everybody's in play.
Exactly.
Everybody can be in the game. And it's not just traditional nation-state threat actors. You know, you've got to factor in all sorts of different cohorts who have their own agendas, including social technology companies.
Absolutely. And I think that's really the issue. I mean, this whole sort of Cambridge Analytica thing that's come up, this had a name in our world anyway, in the hacker community, is called dark marketing. Companies buying basically hacked databases that then would go through this process of being digested into legitimate marketing companies who then did marketing. But they were buying databases that off of the deep web that were sold for, you know, pennies for certain information. And then ultimately it would be used to sell Nike. So as you were saying, there is a level of responsibility, which we talked a lot about, which is really what this is all about, is there is a level of responsibility that neither doesn't exist or hasn't really been thought about, because by the big companies, it's all about what's the bottom line, what's our stock price, are we making money? It's not really about are we being responsible with our community.
And that's a good point, you know, and whatever, you know, we're grown-ups here, we can say, okay, we can make informed choices. What about kids? What about the 7, 8, 9, 10-year-olds who are on these platforms under the age of COPPA regs? What about the 13, 14, 15-year-olds who are struggling to figure out who they are? You know, do we really want their data to be mined and for them to be targeted when they're feeling vulnerable or when they express some vulnerability? Are they unhappy or micro, you know, facial recognition technologies used to actually figure out how you can target them, how you can tap into their psychological Achilles heel? We want technologies that make us better as humans, not that diminish us. And this is the point of responsibility. We cannot legislate our way out of this problem space, because we can never legislate, and maybe we wouldn't even want to legislate. But that doesn't mean we can't have good practice. And Al Gore is going to be speaking here later. And there's an interesting metaphor to coming back to conceptualizing cyberspace as an environment. Now think about the environmental movement. You know, we care about the planet. We care about pollution on the planet. We've got to start caring about cyberspace. So there's an interesting principle in the environmental movement, which is called the precautionary principle. And it dictates that it's not up to us to prove that an oil company is contaminating the ocean. It's not up to us to prove that a water utility company is contaminating the water. It's up to them to prove to us that they are doing no harm. Okay. Now let's transpose the precautionary principle to cyberspace and say to every developer, social technology company, industry in the space, prove to us that you are doing no harm.
Yes.
That is exactly the problem right now. And I mean, the other thing to take into consideration is what happens with one of those companies is, they get hacked all the time. So when that information then gets used by, whether it's in this case was a legitimate quote unquote company, but those companies get hacked and that information then goes back through that dark path. And it's what Mary is saying is exactly it. We haven't even begun to really think about cyberspace as an environment. And that is what it is. And in fact, we're so different. We were having this conversation when we first met in the sense that I was telling Mary, well, you know, when I'm doing that, I don't really know that there's a person on the other side. I don't really think about that. So psychologically, there's a disconnect between your data and you to the hacker. To the hacker, you're just data. There's no human really there. You don't think about the effects that it has on the human. And then we really got into that.
We had dinner together, and, you know, after a couple of hours and a bottle or two of wine, Ralph said to me, he said, Mary, you got mad hacking skills. And I said, well, Ralph, I'm not a hacker. And he said, oh, but you are. You just don't know it.
It's true. I mean, this is kind of one of the ways I like to explain it is, you know, with hackers, there's four kinds of people in the world, people who know things and do something with that knowledge, people who don't know and do something with what they don't know, people who basically don't know and don't do, and people who basically know and don't do anything, right? So at the end of the day, hackers come from not having any knowledge about something but actually doing it, screwing it up, okay? But over time, from doing it, they become very knowledgeable at it. And what they're very good at doing is learning fast. They can go very deep into a subject, technology, and be able to know that technology, reverse engineer that technology without having any knowledge. And that's sort of the skill that hackers have that makes them special. But that's actually I think we all have that skill, and that was the point with Mary, is you're reverse engineering the way that we think, the way that we act, the way that we interact. And that's exactly the kind of reasons that bringing the arts into this is very important, because I think for being in tech, we are, you know, in Hollywood, I just recently had a conversation with someone who said, in Hollywood, they say content is king. And he said, if content is king, then data is the kingdom. And that's what we're living in today. Data is the kingdom that we live in. For being in the world of communications, we are the worst communicators. And the best communicators are in the arts. Film, television, obviously the universal language being music. Yet all of that now rides on this utility infrastructure called the internet now.
And that was the beauty of Saul's piece, you know, the poetry, the images, how powerful that is. And you know, as humans, this is what we do best. This is what we do best. You know, before I met Ralph years ago, I had preconceptions about hackers. I'm sure he had conceptions about scientists. and when we met, you know, we didn't think we would get on, but we did. There's a good story. We were on a panel, and the moderator, and the panel was pretty boring, and the moderator was asking questions, but she didn't know a lot about tech, so it wasn't going anywhere. And then she said to Ralph, so how did you get into hacking? And I thought, oh no, don't ask a hacker how you got into hacking. And Ralph said, oh, I was a 13-year-old boy growing up.
They told me there was porn on these things called BBSs. So I got a computer to go find the porn. I found computers in the process, but then Mary had to go.
That'll never make it onto the school curriculum, you know that.
But it's the truth. I mean, it's what are the motivators? And that's really what we have to look at today, because the motivator used to be just, I want to know if this can be done. You know, curiosity. Yeah. Was the motivator when I got started at 13, 14 with computers. The motivator today is money.
Money, uh-huh.
It's all about money. You know, if you think 3 or 4 years ago, if you would have asked me, well, the Russians, because now that's the thing today is the Russians. The Russians in the past were never involved with geopolitical. You said Russians, that was basically credit card fraud. They own the world of credit card theft and that whole, there's a mob to that, a cyber mob when it comes to that. Would have never thought of a political use of the hackers. Mm-hmm. But I bet you that those hackers, they don't care who's paying them for what, really. They're now being hired by potentially political powers. So the motivator being money is really a big issue. And that's the same that applies to the companies.
Well, yeah.
And the attribution piece is difficult, you know.
Absolutely.
I mean, if you can say you've got the Internet Research Agency and, you know, they placed some ads and, wow, we discovered it and therefore Russia's involved, it's not as simple as that, you know. We have staging in a real-world context, the planting of evidence at a crime scene.
Yeah.
There is also the phenomenon of cyber staging. You know, maybe people want to plant evidence to get in the game, to be perceived to be in the game.
Yep.
And maybe we're looking in the wrong place. Maybe there's a much bigger play elsewhere.
Yep. No, that's, in fact, I've done that personally in certain penetration tests and certain testing of companies where you can just divert their attention completely somewhere else.
Exactly. Look over here. You know, it's a classic.
It's magic.
Yeah.
So with that said, we're coming to the end of our Worlds Collide panel.
Saul.
I really want to thank Saul. I want to actually exit on some of Saul's words because I just love Saul's words.
Over to you, Saul.
Well, no. I'm still on you, Mary, because I'm thinking about computational propaganda. I see the clock here. But I'm just wondering, because I see them bringing in you to help explain the mess. But when I hear you speak, I'm like, okay, if we're going to think of the Internet as an environment, if we're going to shift the way we think about things, because as long as money remains the deciding factor, then we face the same problems, right? How do we get the way you're looking at things into our school systems or into us, like at a younger age or at an age where like we're approaching this and thinking of it as an environment at the beginning, not after we've fucked it up and asked you to clean it up?
It's a really good question. There's no point in talking to 10-year-olds about cyberbullying. You've got to talk to them preschool. You got to teach them early learning netiquette before they get a device in their hands. And they should not have a device in their hands under the age of 2. So that's where we got to start. First of all, we got to factor in the developmental piece. Then we've got to factor in the environment. We've got to factor in the science. And then we can start pointing the finger in terms of attribution.
And with that said, I have to say, we are the problem. Whenever anyone asks me, well, how can I be safer? Well, you can't right now because the problem is a lack of knowledge and awareness of what is going on. The moment you become more educated and aware, then you can do something about it. The only difference between you and I is that I can run a number of pieces of software that you wouldn't even understand what they say. So that's really the focus of these conversations is to create awareness and
understanding. It's dialogue, it's transparency, it's multidisciplinary, it's as humans doing what we do best. You know what we do best as humans? Thinking about problems and coming up with solutions. There is no solutions. There's no form of AI or machine intelligence that can beat us there.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you.
Thank you all.